Hey everybody, I am Zlata, classical violinist, helping violin players overcome their technical struggles and express themselves in music by teaching them all about bowing technique. After my video in which I explained and showed over 24 different violin bowing techniques, which you can find right here, I got often asked, but Zlata, how do I know when to apply which bowing technique where? How do they look like in sheet music? So this video is all about that. But if you want me to show you and explain you all these bowing techniques, then you have to watch that other video that I'll link to in the description underneath. So this is all about notation in the sheet music of those bowing techniques. The difficulty is that sometimes several bowing techniques have the same notation, and other times several notations are used for the same bowing technique. What also doesn't make it easier is that the ways to indicate the bowing technique are quite limited. Besides the up bow and down bow markings, we just have dots, accents, lines, and slurs. That's it. And with that in our toolbox, we must be able to indicate, well, over 24 standard bowing techniques and the unlimited amount of nuances that are in between those. And it also depends on the publisher, because different markings are used for the same piece in different publications. That also doesn't make it easier. So in this video, I'm going to give you guidelines that apply in most of the cases, but it isn't carved in stone. For the bow direction, so up bow or down bow, I made this video and now I'm going into the bowing techniques in sheet music. Is this interesting? Then give this video a like and subscribe to my channel. Let's start with détaché, which is kind of default bowing. You might think it's the simplest, but it is not. Well, in general, détaché is not marked as its default bowing, like here in Bach's Partita in E major. Then if the bow stroke should be clearly articulated, so you really hear the beginning of the note, then dots or lines are used, or a combination of them, like here in Paganini's Second Caprice. An accented détaché is marked just as martelé, like here in Mozart's Fourth Violin Concerto. There are actually 12 types of détaché. If you want to learn more about that and how they look in sheet music, then read my article I linked right here. Legato is luckily easy. It's indicated by a slur above the notes, meaning that you should play those notes on one bow stroke. There are no other indicators like dots, lines, or accents. Of course, in your performance, you are free to add slurs or to break some slurs. Portato is indicated by lines or dots above or below the notes and a slur to connect several notes. You know you have to play the notes on one bow stroke, but you need to make little stops to make them sound separate. You can distinguish it from a flying spiccato or staccato by the fact that a portato is usually in a slower tempo and, of course, look at the musical surroundings. Portato is not always indicated in sheet music. For example, here in the second movement of Vivaldi's Spring, you might play the fourth and fifth note, both up bow. Da, di, da, dum, bum. It's not indicated in the sheet music, but a lot of performers do it anyway, that way. Just as an accent in détaché, martelé is indicated by accents above or below the notes, like here in the Preludium und Allegro by Pugnani Kreisler. Sometimes dots are used, or a combination of dots and accents. Usually dots mean spiccato, but in a lower tempo they can mean martelé or détaché collé, depending on the musical context. When the bow needs to be lifted between the notes and land or slap back, like in collé or jeté, then this is sometimes indicated by a comma between the notes, like here in Shevchenko's 40 Variations. Sometimes the comma is above the notes, like here in the opening of Brahms' Violin Concerto. However, performers can differ what technique is used here and do it in a different way or simply name it in a different way. Other times a combination of dots and accents is used, like here in Kreutzer's Sixth Etude. Spiccato is indicated by dots above or below the notes, like here in the Frühlingssonate by Beethoven. Associé is quite closely related to spiccato, it's indicated in the same way. But as the main difference between spiccato and associé is the speed, associé notes are usually 16th notes, while spiccato notes are usually 8th notes and quarter notes. But this is not carved in stone. Here in Sarasate's Zigeunerweisen, some performers play the spiccato, other performers play associé in a higher speed. For all differences between spiccato and associé, watch this video. Solid or slurred staccato, flying staccato and flying spiccato are all indicated by dots above or below the notes and the slur. That's not easy, isn't it? Again, if you want to see these bowing techniques and have me explain the differences, then watch my video about the 24 different bowing techniques, and I'll link to that in the description of this video. To make it even more complicated, ricochet is also indicated by dots and a slur above the notes. But usually ricochet are 2, 3, or 4 notes, and not a whole run like we see. Here's an example from Paganini's 5th Caprice. You'll recognize a jumping arpeggio by arpeggios over 3 or 4 strings and dots above or below the notes and a slur. So it looks similar to ricochet, but it's over 3 or 4 strings, which jumping arpeggio actually is. And then last but not least, tremolo. You can recognize that by 3 lines through the stem of the note or above or below the note if there's no stem, like here in Bruckner's 7th Symphony. Then what's actually, maybe it is, a bowing technique are double stops, triple stops and chords. Well, you recognize double stops by 2 notes above each other that have to be played at the same time, like here in Bach's Andante. For triple stops there are 3 notes above each other, and for chords there are 3 or 4 notes above each other. Whether you play triple stops or chords depends on the style, the era of the piece, the speed and the performance tradition. Here are, for example, triple stops in the Brahms concerto. After all this, just remember that there are more exceptions than there are rules. And there are thousands of nuances in bowing technique that you can make. The 24 bowing techniques that I teach are just categorizing everything that is possible to be able to learn it. The exact bowing technique is often not clear from the sheet music, and as a performer you have your freedom of interpretation. What to do depends on the musical context, and that consists of the mood of the piece, the style or era it's written in, the speed, the rhythm, the dynamics, the transitions between notes and strings, the tradition of performance, and of course your personal taste. For example, the sol filet in Brooks' Violin Concerto right here isn't marked in any way, but you know you should do it based on the performance tradition, the fact that it's forte, and that there are relatively long notes and the character of the piece, all those factors. So I hope that doesn't make this video completely useless to you. Let me know in the comments if these guidelines are helpful to you. Thank you for watching. Bye bye.